Hello, I am Stéphane Farou and I'll talk about an error that plagues many Oracle developers. But even if Oracle isn't your DBMS of choice, the reason behind this error is independent of the DBMS. This episode is shamelessly based on a tiny part of a very good presentation by Jared Steele called Normalize for Performance that underlines that good performance is linked to good design, something I completely agree with. This story is based on a case that Jared picked from a public forum, and the original poster had trouble implementing business rules in a change control system. The key table in this system is the change control table that associates a database name, a schema name, a user identifier, and two flags that specify whether the user is allowed to change the schema, which is called change authority, or simply to access it, which is called user authority. Now, the business rules are first that a given user can be either or both a change and user authority for a given database schema pair, and second that authority cannot be given to more than three people at once on a database schema pair. Let's in practice what it gives in table change control. As requirements were implemented, when someone has both change and user authority, it can be on a single row, or on two different rows. What matters is that we have no more than three different users for prod and orders, but we may have a different number of rows to represent the same global state. Using triggers is the first idea that most people have when they need to implement complex business rules that cannot be defined as declarative constraints. And we could imagine that each time we have to insert or update a row in change control, we check whether this change would violate the rules. All we have to do is count to how many different users, different from the current one, we have already granted some authority on the schema we're interested in. If we already have three users, then we make the operation fail. Suppose I want to give to users who already have authority on schema orders the same authority on a new schema called purchases. If I run this simple insert statement, it will fail with a dreaded Oracle 4091 error that says that the table is mutating and cannot be seen by the trigger. What does it mean? Even if the error message is scary, it relates in fact to something that is a matter of logic and that I am going to illustrate without a trigger. I am going to create a very simple two-column test table with both columns unique, having an additional unique constraint when the primary key is generated by the system is usually a sign of proper design. The value I associate to key 1 is 0, and the value I associate to key 2 is 1. So, there is my initial state. If I try to set to 1 the value associated to key 1, I violate the unicity constraint, and the operation fails as could be expected. But if in a single operation I switch the values 0 and 1, this is what the mathematical operation does, then the operation succeeds and I get 1 associated to key 1 and 0 associated to key 2. How can it work if I think I operate row by row? Actually, before I run my update, my table is in a consistent state. The update is truly an atomic operation, but not in the sense that a transaction is atomic. I haven't committed my change. Another session would see the consistent state from before the change, while my session sees the consistent state after the change. But what about the state inside the update statement, where my trigger fires? Oracle is right to forbid my seeing anything but the current row, because the table as a whole is in a kind of in-between state, where data may or may not be consistent, Something that the father of the uncertainty principle, the great German physicist Werner Heisenberg, would probably have loved. But even if we understand the reason behind the error message, this doesn't solve in any way the problem faced by the original poster. Unfortunately, much too often people come out with solutions that are creative, but not necessarily the simplest ones. The idea of the original poster was to use a shadow table, which would allow having a trigger that fires on one table and queries the other one. Not a good solution. Something that one sometimes sees with Oracle is also the use of autonomous transactions, transactions within transactions that are great for logging to table information about a transaction that rolls back, but also for happily violating ACID properties and are better forgotten. Tom Kite has suggested on AskTom a solution that involves three triggers. In a before statement trigger, you initialize structures. In the for each row trigger, you simply save the identifier of the currently modified row. And finally, in an after statement trigger, when you are outside the gap in the space-time continuum, you check that the modified rows let the table in a state that doesn't violate the rules. If not, the trigger aborts the transaction. But as Jared underlined, even if the three-trigger solution works well, you can do something much better with a clean design if you can have a say in how tables are structured. Rows in a table represent facts, logic propositions, and they are independent from each other, with a notable exception of unicity, which is required to avoid duplicates. But setting a limit on the number of rows that share some characteristics is, from a relational point of view, meaningless. Meaningless unless, as Jared suggests, you associate to the definition of an authority for a database and schema the idea of a new characteristic that I call slot, which can be 1, 2, or 3. And I am going to redefine the table as change control 2, with a database name, probably a foreign key pointing to another table, a schema name, another foreign key, a slot, with a check constraint that only accepts values 1, 2, and 3, an authority type that only accepts C for change and U for user, and finally a user ID, another foreign key. The primary key will be database name, schema name, slot, and authority, which will ensure that we haven't more than three authorities of each type. And now, if I want with this structure repeat the operation that previously failed, I no longer have any trigger and it succeeds. Alright, at this point you are going to become suspicious and say, that's a bit facile, you are just copying data that is known to satisfy the rules, what about inserting a new authority? How do you assign slots? Fair enough, and I'm going to show you one way to do it. So we have a database, a schema, a username, and authority to grant. For the slot, my preference is to use the same slot that I have already used for this user, for that same database and schema, if the user already has some authority. Now, what happens if the user wasn't granted yet any authority? I'm going to build up a list of all possible slots, 1 to 3. I can left out a join this list with the slots currently in use for this database and this schema. My second choice will be a slot number for which I currently find no match in the change control table. I put the two together. I order by preference and slot number. And as I only need one slot, I only return the first one I find. One more join with the table of users. And this query returns what I need to insert into my change control table. I have never said that SQL is an easy language, but this will far outperform a succession of simple queries intermixed with procedural logic. Now, I can simply take my nice little query and insert what it returns, and to make everything simpler to developers, I am going to wrap everything into procedure. A number of things can go wrong. If the database schema combination doesn't exist, I expect to violate a foreign key constraint. If the authority type isn't C or U, the check constraint will fail. If I try to give twice the same authority to the same user, I violate the primary key. But other things can happen. If there is no available slot, the select statement I've written will return no rows. But I won't get any row either if the username doesn't exist. Therefore, if I fail to insert a row, I must check whether it is because the user doesn't exist or because all slots are taken. I could actually avoid the second query by returning an invalid slot number 4 and catching the violation of the constraint on the slot number, in which case no row inserted and no error would necessarily mean that the username is wrong. I left it to you as an exercise. So, let's check what we currently have in the change control 2 table. In database prod, schema orders as its full ration of authorities, except for user Bob, to whom I could grant a changer authority. In the same database, however, I could give a number of authorities on schema billing. If I grant the change authority on orders to Bob, then it works fine. But if I try to grant any authority to another user, my operation fails with the write error message. By contrast, granting authority to user Fred on billing succeeds. No trigger, and yet complex business rules are perfectly enforced through nothing but declarative constraints. With a good design, well, good SQL skills don't hurt, you no longer have problems of mutating tables, you don't need three different and relatively complicated triggers, and there is no need for horror tales. Thank you.